Good afternoon, Hoosiers. Today we had to change things up a little bit because the governor, of course, can't be with us in person, but he is with us by phone. So, Governor?
Good to hear your voice, Dr. Box, and good afternoon to everyone that's joining us today. Later on today, we'll hear again from Dr. Box and Dr. Weaver, and we have three guests. But before we get to the meat of the program, I did want to share that, as many of you know, members of the Indiana Police Security Detail who work with me and Janet each and every day really are not just like family, but they're as close to us as any family's ever been. And because of the very, you know, nature of their jobs, they frequently are within and must be within 6 feet of us. And not only was it upsetting to learn that some of them had tested positive for COVID in the last day or so, last few days going back now, but some are symptomatic. And as of now, I'm just pleased to be able to report that all are doing well, but Jan and I will continue to keep each one of them in our thoughts and pray for their safe recoveries, as we do for every single person who's dealing with getting through this virus. And what that means, though, is that Jan and I are now compelled to hunker down. We're both in good health as I speak. We're both doing fine, but we were and are have been close contacts. So we'll do the right thing and we'll stay at home, just as we've been asking everyone to do for the collective good. I listen and follow the blunt directions I received from Dr. Box, and she can explain all this in more clinical terms, but Dr. Box has recommended that Janet and I get a COVID test at the end of this week because of the incubation period of the virus. A test later this week will give us a more accurate reading with some days that will have gone by. Contact tracing for the security detail, and for us for that matter, is being handled directly by Dr. Box's staff. And I know they've been working around the clock to complete that task, and we appreciate all the work that's going into that as well. There's just no doubt in my mind that Janet will be tired of having me around home as much as she has seen me in the last 24 hours. So with that thought in mind, I'll move to other things. I will stay on the call after we hear from Dr. Box and Dr. Weaver and our three guests. And then by next Wednesday, after I've had a test, we'll shoot to have the technology in place to where I can join you, Dr. Box, via video as well. But we wanted to wait until we got past the end of this week. So on to other things. The executive order that I signed last week is effective, obviously, and as of now, we'll not make any changes to it. I will be, as always, looking at Dr. Box and her team to bring forward on a hourly, daily basis any new thoughts or ideas, as she is and they are out talking to hospital officials every day and county health officers every day, her cabinet counterparts across state government, and all the local stakeholders that are on the ground dealing with this each and every day. I'm particularly concerned, and we talk about this quite a bit, about the rising hospitalizations and the capacity to be able to treat COVID and non-COVID patients for that matter. I know I sound like a skipping record, but there's a cause and effect to all this. And just to break it down as simply as I can, as we see community spread occur and rise, that leads to cases rising, that leads to hospital admissions rising. And with that, beds are filled. And that has an effect on, you know, a myriad of things, such as elective procedures being either postponed or canceled, or, you know, cancer patients or heart patients having to reschedule appointments, schools locally across the state having to go virtual, and then therefore parents then having to stay home, and then therefore businesses have to figure out how they do more with less, and in terms of how many of their employees are out, and hospital staff, same as any business, who are already stressed out, who have to quarantine themselves. And then obviously the ultimate, we also see the death rate rising. And so I just want to, I don't think I can beat on that drum enough, that with every action, there's an equal or greater reaction, whether it be good or adverse. And the downstream effects from practicing all the best protocol out there is going to make a difference. And having said all that, since we announced additional restrictions recently, there are plenty of examples. You can look every day of county and local officials who have started to or continue to take additional actions that are in the best interest of their long-term community, such as reinforcing mask wearing and limiting hours of operation and checking for occupancy and seating compliance, which is exactly what should be taking place. And we have entities, state agencies, who are postured and ready and are helping on that local front. Yesterday, I participated in a national governor's call, the National Governors Association, bipartisan group that focused on vaccinations. This is all part of the whole continuum. And that is extremely good news to receive, that we're even having this discussion about vaccinations and about therapeutics. But the key is how we get through the next few months until there is widespread distribution of a vaccine, or plural vaccines. And Dr. Weaver on the line will give us an update on Indiana's preparation later on this briefing today. We all discussed, the governors discussed, that again, while there's light at the end of the tunnel, you know, what we do between now and being basking in that light, so to speak, as I always say, is gonna be largely dependent on how we safely negotiate our way through the coming weeks and months. And that means, again, wearing a mask, keeping physically distant from one another if you're in a congregate setting, washing your hands, throughout all these trials and tribulations that we've been experiencing over the last 8+ months. There is a lot of encouraging news surrounding us as well. And I've talked about businesses that are coming back online, not all, but businesses that are coming back online and rehiring and looking for employees. Even the news on Monday, that earlier this week, Monday, I think it was, that the NCAA, that there's great potential that they could bring the basketball championship, all 68 teams, to Indianapolis, Indiana. And, you know, we're already scheduled to host Final Four events for all three divisions, by the way, of the men's basketball championship. So that's, I mentioned Indianapolis, but that's also Evansville, and that's also Fort Wayne. So truly the road to the Final Four is I-69 in the state of Indiana. So when Mark Emmert approached us about the idea to bring the entire event to Indiana, we said, we will do all we can to support a successful and safe tournament. It's obviously a one-time event that Hoosiers will step up, and like we always do in various venues, to make it possible if it's safely doable. And also, let me just say to close, that Dr. Box, again, we've got three guests with us joining Dr. Weaver. Dr. Box has lined up just an impressive group of medical professionals who are, by every definition, those frontline workers who are being stressed and strained like no other time in our state's history. And they're going to be able to articulate and explain that connection between what they do and a local community and therefore at large our state, what's happening in the field on a day in, day out basis, how it's affecting their local medical staff and first responders in their communities, again, all throughout the state of Indiana. So with that, Dr. Box, I'll turn it over to you. I'm thinking that you also mentioned earlier that you were going to touch on the upcoming Thanksgiving holiday and maybe some risk assessments. I know I've had to call an audible myself here.
I'm sure.
Recently, but all families that are going to have to make risk assessments according to their family, not just needs, but considerations. And with that, I'll turn it back over to you and I'll stay on the line until we get to the Q&A portion.
Thank you, Governor. Good afternoon, Hoosiers. We're sending our prayers and our best wishes for both the governor and the first lady and the security team, and we'll continue to pray for them on a regular basis. When we learned yesterday afternoon that members of the governor's security detail had tested positive, our state epidemiologist and her deputy immediately launched our contact tracing process. They started by contacting the individuals who had tested positive and asking about their work and their personal contacts and activities so that we could identify all who were close contacts. They then reached out to those individuals with questions. We asked whether they had been tested and if they had symptoms. If they were symptomatic, we asked when those symptoms first started. In contact tracing, as you know, we go back 48 hours from a positive test or the onset of symptoms to identify who is truly a close contact. From those interviews, we were able to identify approximately 20 close contacts who needed to isolate or quarantine, including the governor and the first lady. With everyone we reached, we explained the importance of isolation and quarantine and the need for individuals in their households to do the same if they had tested positive. We also advised them to get tested if they developed symptoms. The best window for testing is 5 to 7 days after exposure, which is why the governor and the first lady will be tested later this week instead of immediately. These cases and my own experience with COVID are yet another reminder that COVID can strike anywhere, anyone, at any time. And sadly, we are seeing that with increasing frequency in Indiana and across the country. We've been working tirelessly to prevent the surge that we're currently experiencing. We've placed limitations on gatherings with no more than 50 in the orange and 25 in the red. We've had a mask mandate for months, actually since July. We've been telling you how important it is to practice social distancing and to stay home if you're sick and get tested. But if we do not have Hoosiers doing the right things, if we do not have local leaders partnering with their local public health departments and hospital systems to support them and enforce these measures, we are going to continue to see our cases and our deaths skyrocket. Our color-coded county map this week shows 21 counties in red and one in yellow. That leaves 72 counties in orange, which indicates that community spread is at high levels. I want to remind you that these colors are determined by two metrics, the cases per 100,000 population and the seven-day positivity rate. The map you're seeing now is concerning, but if you look at the cases per 100,000, it's even more worrisome. With that single metric, our entire state is in red. I want to repeat, our entire state is in red for our number of cases per 100,000 residents. As you will hear later, our hospitals are struggling under this surge. The number of people hospitalized with COVID or COVID-like symptoms continues to rise and was over 3,000 today. Daily hospital admissions are also at their highest level since the beginning of this pandemic. We continue to hear reports of exhausted nurses and doctors, of hospitals having to hold patients in the emergency room because there are no beds. I also want to emphasize that Hoosiers should not go to the hospital emergency room to get a COVID test. We have around 270 testing sites throughout the state that are appropriate sites for COVID testing. The ER should be reserved for individuals who have symptoms who warrant an emergency room visit, such as shortness of breath, not for routine testing. We also, unfortunately, are seeing an increasing number of deaths, especially among our residents of long-term care facilities. That is why we continue to train the Indiana National Guard members to provide assistance in these facilities. And it's why we continue to develop resources to protect residents and staff in these facilities. While our deaths are heavily impacting people age 70 or older, we have noticed that our new cases are trending back to that 18 to 30-year-old group. This is concerning as colleges and universities prepare to send their students home until January or later. A number of our larger universities are already screening students before they head home. I had phone calls with the majority of our colleges and universities yesterday and offered to provide BioNX Now cards to universities that aren't doing that routine screening so that they can test students before they leave to come home. As of this morning, more than a dozen colleges and universities have expressed interest in receiving BioNX Now cards to test students before they leave campus, and we expect that number to grow. We will deploy these cards yet this week. Every student who is tested will receive information that tells them what the results mean and the steps that they should take. We know that these rapid tests are just a snapshot in time, so we want to remind the students that if they were recently exposed, they could test negative, but just be too early to be showing up positive. So my guidance to every student coming home is this: behave as if you have COVID or have been exposed. When you get home, plan to spend those 14 days in quarantine, even in your own home. Wear a mask, even in your own home. Don't see your grandma or other elderly relatives until you complete that 14-day period without any symptoms. Use a separate bathroom if one is available. And please, don't head out to the bars or hang out with all the friends that you haven't seen for months. You need to keep those social bubbles small. I also want to encourage college students to consider ways that they can work or volunteer through this pandemic. We have partnered with the Bowen Center to create a student reserve workforce as part of our Hoosier Heroes. Opportunities could include serving as a substitute teacher, helping with contact tracing, helping the state and local hospitals as we register individuals to be vaccinated, and many more. The Bowen Center has sent a call out to all college students to recruit people who are willing to help. You can learn more at the link on the slide, bit.ly/student-step-up-to-serve. These are things that you can do to save lives, and those lives might just be your own family members' lives. I know many of these steps are hard, especially with the next week being Thanksgiving. But as I said last week, holiday celebrations need to look different this year. The CDC has issued holiday guidance that stresses that even with friends and family, people need to be cautious during the holidays so that they don't add to the trend of increasing cases. We've posted our own guidance as well as on our website on coronavirus.in.gov. Thanksgiving is a time when families traditionally plan to join larger groups or to celebrate together. But travel increases the chance of getting and spreading the virus that causes COVID-19, especially when you look at the high levels of transmission that many states are experiencing. You might also find that some states are requiring travelers from other states to quarantine for 14 days upon arrival or show proof of a negative COVID test within the past 72 hours. These are all factors Hoosiers should consider when making holiday plans. To be frank, staying home is the best way to protect yourself and others. You can still celebrate by having a small dinner with your immediate family. For the first time, there'll only be five at my dining room table. Or you might want to prepare traditional family recipes for your family and neighbors and to deliver them in a way that doesn't involve close contact. If you do plan to be with people outside your immediate household or social bubble, take steps now to reduce the risk of exposing others. These steps could include setting the expectations up front that any planned visitors will have to follow. Make sure that everyone is prepared to follow those recommendations. Self-screen for symptoms before hosting anyone or going to someone's house. If you have a fever or any other signs or symptoms of illness, stay home or cancel your gathering. Regularly wash your hands or use hand sanitizer and ask those coming into your home to do the same. Put hand sanitizer on the table so it's easily accessible. Clean high-touch surfaces in your house and take steps to increase ventilation. That could include cracking windows open, using HEPA filters and humidifiers, and opening your blinds. We also recommend that everyone wear a cloth mask when you're in indoor settings, even those college students who just came home from the holidays, as I mentioned. The CDC recommends that you avoid indoor settings with people who don't live where you cannot socially distance or wear a mask. If you are having high-risk individuals in your home, set up your house so that you can physically distance while visiting and during mealtimes or other times when a mask cannot be worn. This might mean bringing back the kids' table or having guests bring their own food and drinks. When at-risk individuals are visiting, wear a mask while visiting with them inside your house. That includes riding in the car. If at-risk individuals are staying overnight, have a separate bedroom and, if possible, bathroom for the at-risk individual to use. If possible, get your household tested for COVID-19 in time to receive the results before having high-risk individuals in your home. As hard as it is, we do not recommend taking anyone from a long-term care facility out to celebrate the holiday. These Hoosiers are among our most vulnerable, both in age and in underlying medical conditions, and we want to do everything possible to protect them. The CDC also lists going shopping in crowded stores just before or in or after the Thanksgiving holiday is a high-risk activity, so be aware of the risks as you make your plans. Many stores are starting their Black Friday deals early and offering them online, which makes it easier to get deals without putting yourself at risk or your loved ones at risk. And finally, as you look at our colored county map, know your risks and think about the risks to others. Whether you're looking at a holiday celebration or a wedding, be willing to make the hard choices now to protect the people that you love. I had to have this exact conversation with my brother recently. He and my sister-in-law will probably both be spending the holiday alone because they're both at high risk. As much as I'd like to see him this year, I told him I'd rather have him for the next 20 years celebrating birthdays and anniversaries and holidays with him, his wife, and my family. There will be more than 5,000 empty seats at Indiana Thanksgiving tables this year because of COVID-19. Let's all make those hard choices to prevent that number from growing so that Hoosier families are able to celebrate for years to come. Next, Dr. Weaver is going to provide us with a brief update on the COVID-19 vaccine, and then we'll hear from three medical professionals from around the state about what they're seeing in their hospitals and their communities. Dr. Weaver?
Thank you, Dr. Box. So we continue to actively prepare for the arrival of vaccine. The latest news about the vaccine is very promising. Pfizer is reporting that its vaccine is about 95% effective in final results, and we are hearing similar results from the trials of the vaccine being developed by Moderna. As we said last week, we expect the Pfizer vaccine to be the first one we receive. Pfizer announced today that it plans to seek FDA authorization for the vaccine soon based on results from its final trial. Before the vaccine can be distributed and administered, the FDA will have an outside committee of vaccine experts review the findings from the trial. If those are satisfactory, the FDA can grant an emergency use authorization that will allow the vaccine to be shipped to the states. Those shipments could come as soon as 48 hours after an EUA is issued. Our vaccine review team of physicians, ethicists, and others will review the ACIP recommendations and other research that comes with the vaccine before we begin administering it here in Indiana. We currently have nearly 50 hospitals prepared to administer the vaccine, including the 5 pilot sites that we discussed last week. And again, those are Community Hospital in Munster, Clark Memorial Hospital in Jeffersonville, Deaconess Hospital in Evansville, IU Methodist in Indianapolis, and Parkview Health in Fort Wayne. The final Pfizer trial found that people who received the vaccine tolerated it well, and fatigue and headaches were reported by some recipients, but no serious safety issues were identified. We want Hoosiers to know that no COVID vaccine will be distributed until it is deemed safe by federal regulators and our own state review committee. We know that large percentages of people are hesitant to get the vaccine, in part because they feel it has been developed quickly. But I want to remind Hoosiers of what Dr. Box said last week. This vaccine has not been rushed. It has been developed off of work that has been ongoing for a decade. The vaccine we expect to receive initially has only been tested in individuals 18 years and older, so it will not be available to children. However, Pfizer has expanded its trial to include children as young as 12, so we will be watching for additional research. We also don't know how long protection will last for those who receive the vaccine. That will take additional study from the manufacturers. This first allocation will be for frontline healthcare staff who, in their line of work, have the potential for exposure to COVID-19 patients or infectious material. We will utilize several mechanisms to communicate with them when the vaccine is available for those people to receive it. Throughout the pandemic, we have relied on the tools that we know work while awaiting the development of additional disease-fighting tools. This vaccine will significantly increase our arsenal as we fight COVID and help us to win this battle. Thank you, Dr. Box.
Thank you, Lindsay. Now it's my pleasure to go to Dr. Fish, who is CEO of Schneck Medical Center in a more rural area, just to share with us what they've been experiencing as a hospital system. Dr. Fish?
Good afternoon, Dr. Box, Dr. Weaver, Governor. As we all know, the COVID-19 crisis has caused fear, anxiety, and has stressed our entire healthcare system. You know, every day here at Schneck and at other hospitals, we are faced with the difficulty of maintaining our staffing levels, maintaining and expanding our capacity as our hospitalizations rise. We also deal with shortages continuing in PPE, equipment, and medications 8 months into this pandemic. With increased COVID hospitalizations of critically ill patients, here at Schneck, we've had to go on critical care diversion several times in the past month due to our ICU being full. Most recently, the past 2 days this week, we've been on diversion. We've not had that ability to accept transfers from smaller critical access hospitals in our area as we normally do. These situations present serious concerns for patient care in our area, as well as safety communities we serve. We have challenges in determining where to send patients that need higher hospitals around us and in larger metropolitan areas, Indianapolis, Louisville, are also similar issues and have trouble accepting our patients. On top of the extraordinary stress our healthcare providers are under, we face staffing challenges on a daily basis due to this increase. We have a number of caregivers in quarantine. Some have had to stay home with their children, whose schools have transitioned to online learning. We've attempted to create what we call a clubhouse Schneck, so that our staff can continue to come to work and our kids can virtually learn. We are prepared if that thing, you know, many of our staff members have decided to leave inpatient care and to go to outpatient settings. We've seen that increase over COVID since COVID-19. And some have just overall left the profession due to being burnt out. A number of our staff as well, if not all, are just emotionally and physically exhausted and need a break. You know, these staffing shortages are compounded by increased hospitalizations across the West. Access to supplemental staff is basically non-existent. I mean, every day we try to attempt to hire agency nurses, and they're just not available. So members of our healthcare team who have had who hold clinical, but who support important support roles such as regulatory compliance, risk and safety, information technology, are now being deployed to the front lines to care for patients. And even with this deployment, the demand of patient care exceeds the staffing capacity like ours. Challenges will continue as the COVID positivity rates and hospitalizations continue. You know, and because we've had to redeploy caregivers to inpatient and critical care units, other areas such as surgery, endoscopy, our physician practices have to delay patient care, which is never in the best interest of our patients. I'd say just imagine if your loved one had a preventative screening colonoscopy schedule and that screening was postponed. What if your loved one had a growing tumor that could not be discovered for 2 to 3 months? Or imagine if your wife, your mother, your grandmother, or your daughter had to wait to see their physician to discuss a lump found in their breast. These challenges are real and are happening every day and can affect our ways. You know, when you're a rural hospital, our patients are our friends, they're our neighbors, they're our loved ones. We see them at church, we see them at the grocery store and other places throughout town. And you know, we have obligations to provide comprehensive health care close to home, which has been jeopardized by these rising hospitalizations related to COVID. Unfortunately, we don't see an end in the near future. Our PPE shortages are continuing, our staffing shortages, and rapid testing remains limited, but there is hope. There is hope with promising therapies such as monoclonal antibodies and the preventive vaccines. But what we need is we need the community's help in stopping the spread of COVID. We're in the midst of Jackson counties and Hoosiers across the state to trust the medical evidence and do what they can do to help slow the spread. When you're making your decisions in your everyday life, think of your healthcare team who has been battling this pandemic every day for the past 8 months. Healthcare workers, when you put on your mask, think when you decide to postpone your large gathering. Think of the residents in your communities who are at risk for serious COVID when you keep your distance from others and wash your hands. We need to trust the science. We have to stop making this public health emergency a political issue. This is not a Democrat versus Republican issue. It's a matter of care, concern, and regard for your family, your friends, and your neighbors' health and well-being. If we can all work together, we can make a difference and slow this spread. All of us at Schneck Medical Center appreciate and thank you for your continued support, Governor. We appreciate all you and your team are doing, and thank you for allowing Schneck Medical Center to share our story, and please stay safe.
Thank you, Dr. Fish. Extremely well said. We really appreciate you. I understand you're going to hang on with us for questions in case there's any questions. It is now my pleasure to introduce Sarah Petrowski. She is Vice President of Nursing and Clinical Services at Beacon Health System. Sarah?
Thank you, and thank you for the invite. I'm excited to share a little bit of perspective from our frontline caregivers here in the north of the state. I do echo all of the sentiments Dr. Fish just shared with everyone. We feel that same pain, and I'm happy to know that we're all in it together. I'd first like to share that nurses and anyone who's dedicated themselves to a life of healthcare are risers, in that we rise to the occasion. We want the very, very best for our communities and the patients that we serve. And day in and day out and night in and night out, we are rising to the occasion on their behalf. When there's a need, we're here to fill it. We have had nursing shortages long before COVID-19, and they have stretched us thin. But this pandemic has stretched us and squeezed us in a way that we have never, ever experienced before. Like Dr. Fish shared, there are patients that unfortunately we can't meet their needs right now because we're inundated. We have an abundance of patients, more than we can quite frankly handle right now. And these patients are very, very hard to take care of. Donning and doffing is not new to healthcare. We have done PPE for a very long time, but in the mass amounts that we're doing every single day, makes it incredibly difficult to provide the care that we like to for patients. So we're doing our very best, but it is very hard. And for these patients, I hope people remember they're alone due to the much needed visitor restriction. And so we are their caregivers, we are their friends, and we are their family members. And for our frontline staff, it's very, very emotionally tough for them to be absolutely everything for absolutely everybody. And death and dying has always been part of healthcare. We've dealt with that the entire time we signed up for these careers, but death in the numbers we're seeing with COVID is not what we're used to. We're seeing death at a much higher rate than we've ever experienced before, and it is affecting every single layer of our organization. From nurses to phlebotomists to lab associates who maybe saw those patients just moments before or just even yesterday and had the conversation, and today is their last, all the way down to the security guard who has the honor of transporting them to their last destination with us, which is the morgue. We are averaging at least one death per day at Beacon Health System, and this is more than we have ever experienced or care to, quite frankly. We've taken a vow for no one to die alone. And so this means at times we're teaching family members to don and doff so they can slip into the room for a very quick minute and say goodbye. And sometimes this means that we are their family members and we are holding their hands as they pass when just moments before we tried to save them. It's very, very hard for staff. The emotional toll that this pandemic has created for everyone who works in healthcare will have a very long-lasting effect. This is not normal for us. We have brought on-site counselors, crisis counselors to the facility so that they can talk with our staff in the moment and on the units where they do their work. And this is also not normal. This is very hard for people. We're working very hard across the counties here in Northern Indiana as a team to be everything the community needs from us. We are rising to the occasion, but we are no longer the front line of attack for this. We are the last line, and we need help. We need our communities to pull together. We need them to fight this fight with us. We want to be here when you need us, but we need help in order to continue to do that. We want people to be on our team, and we want people to fight this fight with us. We plead and ask that people wear the mask, wash your hands, please only gather with your immediate family. Having Thanksgiving off from large gatherings means that perhaps you get to see people at Christmas. We need the help. We appreciate the help, and we appreciate all the support everyone sends our way.
Sarah, thank you so much for putting a face on those 5,000 Hoosiers that have lost their life to this disease. I really think that you made it much more personal, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate you sharing that. It's now my pleasure to go to Dr. Mark Lutzkmeier. He is Chief Medical Officer for IU Methodist Hospital, and he is actually in our studio in person. Mark?
Thank you, Dr. Box. So as you mentioned, my name is Mark Lutzkmeier. I'm the Chief Medical Officer for Methodist and University Hospitals, which is otherwise known as the Adult Academic Health Center. We have the largest hospital in Indiana, and we pride ourselves with being able to take care of the sickest of the sick. We not only serve our local community here in Indianapolis, but we also serve as a major referral center for hospitals across the state. And since the start of this pandemic, this has challenged us in ways that we could not comprehend. We've learned a lot throughout this pandemic here. We've cared for more than 1,054 COVID positive patients, and I could not be more proud of our team for the way that we've responded to the challenges of this pandemic. Our ability to care for patients has really changed since the beginning of this spring. And it seems like such a long time ago, but I'll tell you, the emotions that we are going through in this next wave here have immediately come back. It took us a lot of time to go through and prepare for those emotions the first time because we didn't know what we were expecting. But now that we do, and we've seen some of the warning signs and know what the next few weeks are going to bring us, I'll tell you, our healthcare providers are really feeling that stress and angst right now. And so we do need your help. But we are absolutely committed to care for the patients that need our care. We are definitely strained. And you're hearing this in all hospitals throughout the state. This is not a regional problem. This is not a city problem. This is an entire Midwest problem. And so as our hospitals fill up and we see this, a lot sicker patients here, it's really challenging us to be able to withstand and continue to provide the care that we think we are able to provide here. When we talk about capacity and we talk about our ability to care for patients, we really got to think of this in three ways. So one is, do you have the supplies that you need to take care of patients? The second is, do you have the physical space that you need to take care of these same patients? And the third and the most important one is, do you have the highly skilled care team that you need in order to do this? The first time around, we were more concerned about the supply standpoint. I can tell you, as a health system and a hospital right now, we're not as concerned with that. We've taken that time from the first wave to really try to build our resources up. From a space standpoint, we have a big hospital. We have care spaces, and we're working on identifying some additional opportunities in those care spaces that we haven't used for a long time. That's going to still take some work, but we're actively working on that. What worries me the most, and what you're hearing pretty consistently from all of us, is that the health of our team members is most important. So a bed is just a bed. A room is just a room. But if you put that with highly skilled professionals, that becomes a hospital. And that's really what matters to us. And the health and safety of our team members, who are also members of our community, are really important to take care of. And as we go through this and we see the level of angst, the amount of work, and the higher level of acuity we're seeing, not only in our COVID patients, but also in patients who don't have COVID, who may have delayed care, who we have may have delayed care in that first wave, is really tough. And we know we're up for a challenge here in the next few weeks to few months. And we're readying ourselves to be as prepared as possible, but we do need your help because we can't keep this up for a long period of time. And as you've heard, we're all fighting and competing for the same resources from a people standpoint. All of us are looking for additional help outside our health systems to help bolster our team members who are currently in quarantine. If you look at IU Health as a system, we have around 686 team members today currently in quarantine. And when you think about the amount of employees that are at IU Health, which is about 34,000, that may not seem like a big percentage, but every person means that's in quarantine means that may be one less patient that we're able to take care of. And so that's really important for us to try to keep our team members and patients safe. We are going to be here. We know that there are ramifications to rising COVID cases and the community spread, and we see that delayed in the increased number of hospitalizations that are required. We've more than doubled our COVID hospitalizations since the beginning of November in our Methodist hospital. We're up to 80 patients right now, 30 of which are in the ICU. And critically ill. And we expect these numbers to continue to increase as you look at that trend in the community spread. So that has us really nervous. And so we're working very hard, long hours, and really working at the edge of our emotions to be able to continue to provide that care here. I want to thank really the Department of Health in Marion County as well as the state for the partnership and the leadership that we've partnered with over the last several months as we've taken some lessons learned. We know the best practices. We know simple practices. We know how to treat these patients. But we also need to actually do that not only for ourselves but for our community here. So I'll put one final plea in that. Please wear a mask. Please socially distance. Please limit your social gatherings. It matters to us and it matters to our community. We're all in this together, and the only way that we're going to come out of this better than when we came in it is if we all do it together. There's a resiliency that you can build when you have everybody aligned in trying to do their best. And it is exhausting if we have anything less. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lutkemeyer. I just want to say it's those very simple mitigation procedures that can make such a difference. And thank you for your honesty and transparency and sharing. Now we better go to Rachel so we can get some questions.
Yes, we'll take questions for the next 20 to 25 minutes. And we'll begin with Tom Davies of the Associated Press.
Hello, thank you. I've got a question here and then a follow-up. How much higher should people expect these hospitalizations, ICU treatments, and new infections to keep going? Is there any sign of these metrics slowing down, or do you expect this peak to continue all throughout the winter months without the curve slowing down?
I can't predict how much higher it will go, but I can tell you that we're on an exponential growth curve right now, and we do not expect this to turn around quickly. In the next several weeks, we will continue to see cases climb, individuals hospitalized, and unfortunately more deaths. And that's why the plea now to the general public to do those basic simple things that may seem small and very irritating to you, but could make a tremendous difference in the lives of other individuals and the health of other individuals and the support and that our hospital systems are able to provide.
John Boyle, WFPL.
Hello, we have some guidelines just for a lot of general businesses and activities within the state, but I wanted to ask specifically about indoor live performances. I understand the capacities for each county, but I wanted to hear a little bit about whether you believe these types of events should be happening even with those capacities, and also what happens if they are found to not be enforcing masking and social distancing requirements.
So I think it depends a little bit on what event you're talking about. I think if it's a small area like a bar and you have, you know, live singing and dancing, that is not social distancing. That is oftentimes not wearing your masks, and that is going to be a tremendous risk factor. I think if it is in a large event space and everybody has the ability to spread out 6 foot, and we have the ability to wear our masks, that might quite be possible. But I think that's why we've really looked to our local public health people, local elected officials and businesses to decide where can we actually social distance, where can we control people wearing their masks, and then to go back and to spot check those. And if businesses or venues are not enforcing that plan that they approved, then I think that's when we need to say, you know, you're going to get a warning now, and next time we may be closing the venue or stopping whatever that particular event is at that time. Those are very difficult decisions to make, but those are the kinds of decisions we need to make at this time.
Kayla Sullivan, Fox 59.
Hi. What is your reaction to the fact two members of the Indiana House did not wear a mask on the House floor yesterday? And how does this undermine what the state's trying to do with the statewide mask mandate? What do you think about those same lawmakers filing a resolution to end the public health emergency? Because they say Hoosiers have the information they need to keep themselves safe from COVID-19.
So, Kayla, I would say that I also look at the fact that everybody but two actually were social distanced and had their masks on, and they actually dismissed themselves from the particular chamber in separate groups so that they did socially distance better. So I'm very excited about that and proud of that. That being said, there is no single Hoosier in this state that is not or should not follow the mask mandate, not only to protect themselves, but to protect other individuals. I'm sorry. Oh, Governor, you have...
Yeah, I would just say, Kayla, as well, that I appreciated the vast majority, all but two, obviously, wearing a mask. It does set the right example. It's not just an example. It's what Dr. Bosch just said. It works. And it provides more certainty than just distancing yourselves. And obviously it will be the policy. It is the state policy, but it's locally enforced, just like it is, you know, the Chief Justice, they put out their set of guidelines and they will enforce their body, as will the legislative branch, as will the executive branch. And so we have a policy in place. It's there because it works. And we leave it, obviously, to the local entities to enforce. And as you've just heard, because that's the way it will work, by the way, and is working. And you've just heard from Eric, Sarah, and Mark about the real life, real time implications of pretending that masks and physically distancing, washing your hands, or lack thereof, that they don't work. We know this will work, and we know going into the next 60 days, that we need to do more of this, not less. And so I would just put a shout out and a special note of appreciation, not just to the leaders, but to the members who are following best practices.
Britt from Wayne TV.
Good afternoon. So I was wondering if, as we see cases rise, and I know earlier you said specifically we're seeing more cases in the 18 to 30-year-old crowd. We just saw Ohio implement a curfew. Is there any chance that could be considered as something here in Indiana?
Governor, you want to take that one?
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Look, everything's always on the table, and we discuss a lot of options on a daily, weekly basis. What I mentioned earlier, just somewhat in passing, is we are starting to see more and more communities, local government entities as well, apply more restrictions or enforce guidelines and recommendations, policies that are already out there. And so when I see capacity limits come online from in Delaware County or in Allen County, or when I see the South Shore Line say we're going to enforce 100% mask mandate on this line, those are good things. Or Vincennes University going, canceling in-person instruction because maybe it's just not safe right now. Those local actions are proof that this is working and will work in that local environment. But the bottom line is this takes state and local partnerships, as was mentioned, making sure the state is getting the resources too. And I should just say that, you know, last week we talked about carving out at this moment $20 million of CARES Act funding to go toward local efforts. And the IFA, the Indiana Finance Authority, is finalizing that guidance right now in conjunction with AIM, our municipality organization, and cities and towns, and with AIC, with the county association, to make sure that not only is there guidance out there, but how can we help folks educate and enforce on the ground?
Andrew Smith, RTV6.
Hi, good afternoon.
Andrew, sorry, I hit a wrong button. Try again.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hi, so I have two quick questions. My first one is, we're hearing that people can't get a test without symptoms, and even at the Optum site, some sites are only scheduling a week out, plus getting the results is taking up to 6 days. Yep. Dr. Box, is this, you know, acceptable in what the state is doing to, and what is the state doing to increase the testing capacity? And then just a quick question on the vaccine. Once that vaccine comes out, if some places like large venues start requiring people to get the vaccine in order to come, are they going to get some sort of a proof, or how are people going to be able to prove that?
So I'll start and then we'll let Lindsay take the vaccine question. Most assuredly, Indiana, like every other state in the country right now, is struggling to keep up with the vast number of tests that we're doing. As you recall, we, if you look at our daily testing numbers, there are 55, 60,000 tests a day, which is a huge number of tests. Indiana is trying to make use of every single type of test that we have, including point-of-care tests, including the BioNX Now card tests, those point-of-care tests that are done quickly and do not have to run through our labs. We are also looking to make sure that we are bringing on additional labs here in the state of Indiana so that we can divide and conquer the labs, the number of labs that we have. Honestly, there are some shortages of different materials, plastic materials that the labs need to run some of these labs. So it's really a juggling act similar to what we had early on with testing. I also would say that right now, Optum sites are still testing asymptomatic individuals. And we still encourage people, especially people that are close contacts, especially people that work in long-term care facilities or other areas, hospitals, or live with someone who would be at risk, to go ahead and get tested. But yes, our turnaround times are running longer than we want. So we're working on all of these other avenues to try to bring that turnaround time down.
Lindsay? Yeah, I would just add that if you go to our coronavirus.in.gov website and hover over the different places that you're looking to get tested, that some places that are not the Optum sites or our local health department sites do have restrictions and maybe to symptomatic people. But if you go to that site, it should have that information, or maybe call ahead to find out if they're restricting, because like Dr. Box said, it's not just our labs that are associated with the testing sites that we support, but it really is the labs across the entire state and across the entire nation, unfortunately. As far as vaccine, so we don't expect to have enough vaccine to vaccinate the general public until late spring or even summer. So, of course, when people get the vaccine, even in this first round, they will have a notification on their phone. They'll have a paper, just like often you get when you go get a flu shot, that acknowledges that they've had the vaccine. So in the future, I think that's something that we will definitely keep in mind if that becomes a requirement. But unfortunately, we don't expect that mass vaccination for quite some time. And in the meantime, we're really going to focus on our frontline healthcare workers and our vulnerable populations.
Yeah, and that vaccine will go into our immunization system so that their private healthcare professionals can actually go and retrieve that from the system and have that as a part of their medical record.
Absolutely.
Michael from WKVI.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yep.
All right, I had a quick question about contact tracing. And we're seeing local health departments now trying to hire additional nurses to help with the contact tracing process. I was just wondering, what's the status of the state's centralized contact tracing? And I guess, why isn't it able to fill that need at this point?
Well, it's strictly the number of positive cases that we have that is overloading our labs, is also overloading our contact tracers. And so, as I have mentioned, we continue to hire and add more cohorts. I think there'll be an additional 600 contact tracers that come on in the month of November, bringing us probably close to 1,500 to 1,600 in addition to what our local public health individuals have. But we also are looking to actually be more targeted with that initial interview and paring that interview down and really starting to rely on talking to individual patients that are positive, making sure they understand that they're positive and what isolation looks like and the importance of how they need to share information and provide that information to them so that they can share it with their close contacts. So as we go forward, we will probably be changing the process a little bit just so that we can make sure we do reach out to every person that's positive and start to rely on individuals who are positive to be responsible in notifying other close contacts.
Nikki Kelly with the Fort Wayne Journal Gazette.
Hi, Governor. I had two quick questions. The first is, have you guys identified a level of ICU bed usage that might spur new action, whether it's 5% or only 100 beds left, something like that? And then secondly, as far as enforcing your new order, I wanted to make sure whether state agencies will be doing any of that enforcement, for instance, ATC shutting down a bar or pulling a retail certificate, or are you just really dumping all of that on the locals?
No, and you remind me, Nikki, that maybe Steve Cox should join us Wednesday. We've done a number of, when local communities have reached out to us, whether it be the ATC, or Homeland Security, well over 100 visits and supporting local efforts on not just education, but also just trying to persuade folks to do the right thing and follow the guidelines, especially those that are locally being attempted to bring numbers down, community spread down. So this is, like I say, it's a partnership. It's not just leaving it to them. We're out over the whole state every day working with businesses who may not be complying with local guidelines as well, or our policies. Your first question, but Nikki, I will get you exact numbers on what's occurred on that front. The first question is no, we haven't settled on one hard fast if it hits this percent, because there are multiple factors that we look at. And Dr. Box, you might chime in if you want on that first question that Nikki had, right, in terms of hospitalization rates or beds or presumptive cases or, you know, COVID beds that are being taken right now. And staff, Nikki, is also what you heard from Sarah, Mark, and Eric is, yes, resources. We have to, we can't spill our resources. We have to be very efficient about deployment of resources. That's why we're, as a state, leaning into trying to complement and assist locals as they enforce. But it's the staff members that are equally important as beds, et cetera.
Yeah, Nikki, I think the governor said it very well, and that is that we can make a bed, we can make a room, we can, I think, as Dr. Lutkemeyer said, you know, we can make a room with the equipment that we need, but it only becomes a hospital and a healthcare system when you add the staff into that. And we do have five regions around the state right now that are just below that 20% of their ICU beds available. So certainly something that we are discussing on a daily basis with hospital systems and regions across the state of Indiana.
Rob Burgess with the Wabash Plain Dealer.
Hello, good afternoon, and Governor, I wish you and those around you better health. Dr. Box, I had one question for you and then one for the governor after that. Dr. Box, 2 weeks ago I had the chance to visit the ISDH free drive-through testing clinic in Wabash. Afterwards, I asked the ISDH about when they expected to reopen this clinic, and I was told they moved their testing operations based on need and input from communities, so they couldn't predict. I then asked our mayor about it, and he said the ISDH was the ones who made the final call. Meanwhile, our 7-day positivity rate for unique individuals locally is at 20% as of today. So is there a threshold we would have to cross to get another free testing clinic to open up? And if so, what is it?
So almost every county in the state of Indiana is above 15% positivity right now. So it's really difficult to use those particular metrics to determine. A lot of times what we do is we look at what other sites are available, where we have been testing, who seems to be going up higher, where we have issues where hospital systems are having trouble keeping up with the number of sick patients. So there's a lot of different factors that go into that. And right now, based on our workforce, we have enough to be able to run about five of these sites just as the Department of Health every week. But we also are supporting, as you know, 78 or 79 different local health department sites across the state, and also supporting all the Optum sites across the state. So we are working continuously to add additional sites. We are currently looking at some of our Optum sites that are overbooked and overrun, and do we need to add an additional lane there? And or are there particular communities that before didn't really want to be associated with a local health department testing site or didn't feel the need for an Optum site, but now we see it's clear that they need to have a site. So all of those things are being looked at and addressed right now.
Okay, great. And then, Governor, the state's election certification deadline is noon on Tuesday. Based on what you've seen thus far, how confident personally are you and how secure and accurate the election was in our state this time around?
I am very confident in our election here in the state of Indiana. I was going into it, and I am coming out of it. Have faith in our system. It's worked for over 240 years for our nation, and I'm proud of the work that, and this isn't a partisan statement, obviously, I'm really proud of the work that from Secretary Lawson to every county clerk to every volunteer that helped us pull off a safe and secure election. I salute them all.
Our final question is from Sherry from the Indianapolis Star.
Hi, my question is for any of the three healthcare professionals who are on the call. I hope some of them are still on. It's kind of a variant of what Nikki asked. At what point do you see your hospitals having to ration care in some way, or you know, kind of go to a surge level capacity? And is there anything other than everyone complying with what state recommends, is there anything else that you'd like to see the state doing to help bring home to people, gee, we're serious about this, wear your mask, social distance, don't hop on a plane for Thanksgiving or Christmas?
Mm-hmm. I'll take that. I think the state is doing what they should do. I think we as a population have the opportunity to control that. And I think that's what we're trying to get that message as healthcare professionals out, is that this is a real situation. But I think the state is doing everything they should be doing. You know, I think we are working our surge plan in our area. Yeah, so I don't think it's not a matter of when will that happen. It's happening today. And we meet on a daily basis here at our facility, and you know, to the comment earlier about beds, we'll run out of staff before we run out of beds. and we'll run out of ventilators before we run out of staff and beds. So capacity, Vapotherm, another type of deliver oxygen, we'll run out of those, and those are in very short supply as well. So, but, you know, we've activated our surge plan here, and we're working it every day.
Anyone else want to contribute?
Sure, I would love to echo his Dr. Fish's sentiments again in that we are in our surge plan. We've already enacted that. We are 10 ICU beds over what our normal capacity is, and the majority of those patients are on ventilators, so they are a very high acuity patient. We are already rationing care in the sense, and so are our partners in the northern region, in that we have slowed down surgery. So as was already mentioned earlier, people who need a screening exam, a screening colonoscopy, or an outpatient elective procedure that helps them with whatever they've got going on, we're not able to do that right now because we need to deploy that staff to help us with the high acuity cases we have on the inpatient side of the hospital. So not only are we in a surge plan, but we are already rationing care. I agree the state is doing what they need to do. We as a community need to do what we should do, which is follow the mandates and the recommendations and do our part to help everyone in healthcare make it through this.
Thank you so much, Sarah. We really appreciate it. And we'll see you back next week at the same time.
Dr. Mark wanted to weigh in real quickly.
I'm so sorry. Mark.
I was going to echo the same sentiments. We've planned for the surge earlier this year. Those same principles apply. You know, I think what we'll see is increased wait times before we see cessation of care. And we're trying as hard as we can to accommodate the sickest of the sick. And that would really be our priority. You know, we did see some impacts from delaying some care earlier this year in what we call our elective cases and some of the elective screening procedures that were deemed a lower acuity. And so we're really trying to get through all of that. So I think be patient. We will definitely continue to deliver the care we need to, but it may take a little longer for us to do that.
Thank you for joining today's briefing. Governor Holcomb's next briefing will be next Wednesday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern.